that I really like qualitative discussions. There's so much quantitative linguistics now, and some of our numbers don't appeal to me so much. So, but why didn't I become a generative linguist? So I thought about this first in, remember in 1983 when I was a undergraduate student at the University of Vienna, and Bert Heider was my syntax teacher, and you know, I was in his office, I was part of the library, and he got a phone call, and he said, oh, Höskuldur, that's nice, so Höskuldur Þráinsson from Iceland had given me a phone call, and that was sort of for me a symbol of this kind of international community of Germanic linguists sort of working together, and I really liked that, and that didn't exist so much in other fields, and I thought, I want to be part of such an international community as well, so I was tempted to become a generative linguist, but didn't, and then 10 years later, in 1992, I was a doctorate student in Berlin, and Paul Kiparski was there on a sabbatical at the Institute for Advanced Studies, and he told me, Martin, you're so smart, why don't you join the mainstream? Why don't you express your ideas in kind of more mainstream fashion, so you will have much more impact? Why don't you do that? And so again, you know, there was a serious thought of, you know, why not become a generative linguist? So I thought a lot about it, and in that sense, I'm maybe even an anti-generativist, because I've thought, why I'm not a generative linguist? So I'm presenting sort of alternatives, and that's very different from many other non-generative linguists, in that they very often just dismiss generative linguistics because they don't make an effort at all to understand it. They just say, oh, these people are crazy and so on. And that, for me, that's kind of intellectual laziness, but then of course you cannot pay attention to everything. So, you know, even these other non-generative linguists are nice people, and everybody is nice, of course. And so here, let's try to think a little bit about, you know, how one can approach things differently. So I'm interested in understanding the limits on diversity. I'm sort of presupposing that there is diversity, though, of course, as Mark earlier said, from some perspectives, you might not even expect that. So the world around us presents us with diversity in quite different domains, different chemical compounds and elements, biological species, languages, grammatical units, recipes. And I think it's a task of science to find the causal factors that put limits on the observed variation. So this idea of causal explanation is something that for some reason hasn't been around much in linguistics and generative linguistics. And I find that maybe that's something that's missing. I learned about this in the context of the interdisciplinary Max Planck Institute that I've been involved in. So, you know, one example, this came across my Facebook feed of explaining limits on variation from MIT Technology Review a couple of weeks ago. There was a paper on flavor networks revealing the universal principle behind successful recipes. Given the number of ingredients that humans eat, the total number of ways to combine them is on the order of 10th to the 15th power, and yet the actual number of recipes we eat is around 1 million, a small fraction of the total. That strongly suggests an organizing principle that in recipe terms sorts the wheat from the chaff. So that appealed to me immediately because I thought, well, yes, there are so many more possible languages that we could imagine, and this really is only a small part of that. So how do these comparative food scientists approach this question? And you know, to what extent would comparative language scientists use similar approaches for understanding the limits on diversity? I think both in biology and in culture studies are generally two kinds of constraints that explain gaps in the attested variation. There's representational constraints and functional adaptive constraints. So, you know, again, some new terminology that you have to learn. Sorry, I have a recent short paper, and it's not on my website yet, but it adds two more, but here only these two are important. So representational constraints are limits imposed by the underlying building blocks. So you know, metaphorically, you can think of that as a DNA in my title, but of course I mean what people generally call UG. The functional adaptive constraints are the limits imposed by the likelihood to survive in a process of variation and selection. So this would be evolutionary adaptation, and that's why my title includes DNA and evolution. So I'm interested in these two kinds of constraints. and for representational constraints, of course, there are all these things that really don't vary across languages, you know, like features, categories, and dependencies and hierarchies, what David just talked about, and I can completely agree that we really need these. They're there, but somehow I find them, they're sort of outside of my purview. What I do find interesting is constraints such as grammars don't count. You know, why don't we have grammatical systems where you say you can have only three adjectives before a noun, but not four adjectives or so? I could easily imagine such a language. Or, you know, that there are no grammatical markers for color or symmetry, as we just saw in the Tani quote from David's presentation. Now, in addition to these representational constraints, or UG constraints, there are also functional adaptive constraints on language structures. And the simplest one is that rarer words strongly tend to be longer across languages for reasons of efficiency. So this is not a kind of hard constraint, the way that we used to see grammatical constraints. You know, it's not a discrete thing. It's just a very strong and clearly universal cross-linguistic tendency. So you also see this with grammatical markers like adposition. So the in-adposition is always shorter than the through-adposition, for example. And this seems to be due to efficiency. It would be very inefficient if things that you do frequently were long and the things that you do rarely were short. Sorry, I'm not being timed.
You are being timed, and you have 12 minutes. Not 11.
12 minutes. Now, if we look at chemistry, things are a bit different because it seems that the notion of functional adaptive constraints doesn't apply there. So the full burden of explanation is on the representational constraints, so the underlying building blocks, the atoms and their properties. And Mark Baker has written a very nice book about this in 2001, The Atoms of Language, which I really liked, and I wish that more generative linguists wrote such really accessible books that don't require kind of reading all the other 20 papers that are cited in order to understand. So he makes a very nice case for parameters being like chemical elements, basically. But, you know, as David just agreed, in linguistics as a biology, both the underlying building blocks of DNA, UG, and evolutionary processes play a role, and also in Tobias Scheer's position statement, I found this contrast between universals produced by grammar versus universals produced by the real world, and I assume that's basically this kind of distinction. But now, more concretely, which universals have which kinds of explanation? We won't make progress unless we compare both kinds of explanation. And although David just agreed in his presentation with this, in actual practice, this isn't happening in linguistics. I just don't see people sort of discussing these things. So maybe at the next conference of this type, there should be sort of actually call for joint papers by people sort of arguing for opposite views and then trying to find some kind of commonality or trying to find the boundaries. So maybe we don't even agree on the basic principles for how to assess proposals for functional adaptive constraints versus representational constraints. The principles that I've been working with are the following. First, if there's poverty of the stimulus, as I think in these position papers, especially formulated by Giorgio Magri, then the default is the representational explanation. So then we have UG. By contrast, if a functional adaptive explanation is available, then the default is a functional adaptive explanation. So for example, for the absence of color in grammatical systems, there is no functional adaptive explanation that I can think of, and Tani also noted this. So hence the default doesn't apply, and therefore maybe a UG explanation works. But if a functional adaptive explanation is available, like in the situation of why is the in word shorter than the through word, then that should be adopted. So that's sort of my approach. And I challenge you to answer this question, is anything wrong with these principles? If not, then I think a lot of what generative linguists have been doing is just wrong, because functional adaptive explanations are available. And that's the reason why I'm not a genital linguist, because I am interested in these functional adaptive explanations of phenomena that can be explained functionally adaptively. So I'm also a bit frustrated by the fact that generative linguists very rarely make specific claims about unknown structural traits on the basis of stimulus poverty. So poverty of the stimulus is always this philosophical argument, but then when you actually get down to details, people very rarely make an argument about something being unlearnable on the basis of the poverty of the stimulus. So you know, David just presented this nice analysis of the personal agreement in Scots English. Here, there's really no poverty of stimulus, right? All these forms are heard very frequently. So this complicated machinery is pretty redundant, right? You can just store this combination, I was, you were, he was, and also you was, and you just learn these in a rote processing way, and one simply doesn't need this. So stimulus poverty in very many cases doesn't seem to arise. Okay, so I'm not going to get through all the slides of the handout, but it doesn't matter. You have the handout, you have the position paper, so I'm just going to talk to you with something. So next is a plea of reproducibility and cumulativity of research results. I think the successful science produces not only ideas, hypotheses, and theories. We have a lot of these in linguistics, but real discoveries. And you know, I wonder, what are the real discoveries of linguistics? I think success, the distinction between ideas, which are not success yet, they're nice, but discoveries are success. Success is measured by reproducibility and cumulativity. If findings of one research team can be reproduced by another research team, and if findings of one generation serve as a foundation for more and better findings of a subsequent generation. And I think we have too little of this. There's no reproducibility discussion in linguistics. In psychology, they're in a serious crisis because they have this as a criterion. In linguistics, why don't we even ask about this? And in linguistics also, we don't build very much on what earlier generations found out. So I think if we did a lot more, if we did more broadly comparative research, then we could remedy some of these problems. Of course, linguists, you know, why does someone become a linguist? Because they're interested in one particular language. Fine. That will probably always be the same. But language-particular systems are social conventions that are largely the result of historical contingencies. They don't tell us very much about human language. So, you know, Buckley Scott's English probably doesn't tell us much about human language. I think it's really only universals that potentially tell us about human language. So if you want to make claims about convention aspects of language, you need to study a very broad range of languages around the world. So we should encourage more of our students to compare languages worldwide. But of course, if those of us who also have an interest particularly in one language, then they should continue to study that language, but perhaps, you know, be careful with making very general claims. Also the micro-comparative studies. Right? I mean, it's really so wonderful to have all these dialects that are studied in Europe now, but they're unlikely to give results relevant to questions about general constraints, either of the representational or functional adaptive kind, because dialects of a single language all descend from a common ancestor and are in addition strongly affected by diffusion or dialect borrowing. So the same is true for groups of closely related languages, so the Scandinavian languages, the Bantu languages, right? You cannot make any conclusions on parametric variation based on such closely related languages. And you know, Keynes has advanced this idea that dialects are a laboratory, but this is true only to the extent that results of such studies can be reproduced in different parts of the world. So dialect 1 of some European language has features AB and dialect 2 has features CB. This is not evidence for a correlation unless you also find dialect 1 of language somewhere else in the world which also has AB and dialect 2 which also has CB. But otherwise, I don't really see how one can draw general conclusions. So this slide I just skip, and I have quotations here from Newell and Adger. They seem to agree that some phenomena are functional adaptability explained, and then I move on to the final thing. The last two or three years, I've come to the conclusion that perhaps one of the most fundamental aspects in practice that distinguishes generative linguists from me is the natural talent assumption. So the idea that the categories and features of languages are potentially the same across all languages. So in chemistry, we do make that assumption, and we look for the same kinds of elements we find on Earth, also on Mars. And similarly, linguists often, you know, when they go to Quechua, they ask, does it have gerunds, determinants, does it have clefts, does it have WH movement? You know, these kinds of notions are assumed to be natural kinds in the sense that potentially Quechua could have a cleft. So cleft is defined in such a way that, that one can identify it. And this is what I'm questioning. So biocultural systems, you also see culture-specific categories arising, so kinship categories, younger sister, uncle, different sex sibling, governance categories, chief, king, mayor, president, religious categories, angel, gospel, surah, shaman, food categories, dumpling, noodle, sandwich. You know, this is really rampant in culture, and I think it simply makes no sense to go to a different culture and look at their religion and ask, what are the gospels? You know, where's the shaman in Catholic religion? You know, where's the supa in Islam? So these are just wrong questions. And so instead, I think linguists, comparative linguists, need to work with comparative concepts because this natural talent presumption is a problem. So these are some really serious issues that I've been grappling with, and it would be nice if you thought something about these questions.
Thank you.